in week two of this Christmas series called Christmas Playlist. And throughout this series, we're looking at the classic Christmas carols that we all know and love. And we're really trying to understand the true meaning behind these lyrics. And obviously, today is also a very special day because it is Christmas Miracle Sunday. And we get to bless some families today. We get to bless some community organizations as well. By far, one of our most favorite days of the year. Well, when we think about giving gifts to others and celebrating Christmas, we all think of really two things, don't we? We think of Santa Claus and we think of the birth of Jesus. We think of those two things. And I think a good question to ask is, where did all of this originate from? Where did it all come from? Why do we celebrate the way that we do? Well, you might be surprised to know that in the very early years of Christianity, Easter was the main holiday that was celebrated. It was all about the resurrection of Jesus. It was celebrated around the world, and the birth of Jesus was not celebrated at this time. And it wasn't until the 4th century when church officials decided to institute the birth of Jesus as a holiday, and Pope Julius I chose December 25th as the day to celebrate. And now millions and billions of people around the world will celebrate the birth of Jesus on that day. And then there's this guy named Santa Claus. And however, the story of Santa Claus really begins with St. Nicholas, who was born during the 3rd century in a village on the southern coast of Turkey. His wealthy parents, who raised him to be a devout Christian, died in an epidemic while Nicholas was still really young. Nicholas went on to use his whole inheritance left by his parents to assist the needy, the sick, and the suffering. And here's a rendering of a picture of St. Nick. And it was under the Roman Empire of this time who actually ruthlessly persecuted Christians. And Nicholas, who became a bishop, actually suffered for his faith in God. And he was exiled and he was imprisoned because of his faith. He died on December 6th, AD 343. And because he was so loved by people, the anniversary of his death actually became a day of celebration. And in 1804, the New York Historical Society promoted Nicholas as a patron saint of both society and the city, thus Saint Nick. And in January 1809, Washington Irving published a fictional story called Knickerbocker's History of New York, with numerous references to a jolly Saint Nicholas character. And it told of this generous man that gave to all in need, and that St. Nicholas came down the chimney to bring gifts to children. And thus, Santa Claus began. The question is, why did St. Nick give his entire inheritance to those in need? He was the real Santa Claus. Why would he give to those in need? And history tells us it was because of a gift that he received when he was young. And that gift that changed his life was a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. A personal relationship with Jesus. And he said he was simply obeying the words of Jesus when he said, "Go sell what you own and give your money to those in need." He dedicated his life to serving God and became known throughout the land for his generosity to those in need, especially towards children. You see, the greatest gift that even Santa Claus received was the birth of Jesus. I think that's a pretty cool story. So why would this gift be so impactful for someone like Nicholas? Someone who opened up his heart and his life to a personal relationship with Jesus. And it really is about this Christmas carol that we're going to talk about this morning for just a moment, that was written between the 8th and 12th century, if you can believe that, that we're still singing this today, this carol, O Come, Emmanuel. And the chorus starts this way. It says, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to you, O Israel. And this was saying that Israel, this whole nation of people, was lonely and in captivity until the Son of God, Jesus, was born. Until the Son of God appeared. And why was it until then? Why this word until? Until the Son of God appeared. Because the birth of Jesus changed everything for them and actually changed everything for us 2,000 years later. Look at this. The gospel writer Matthew wrote this in Matthew 1:23. Look at this. It says, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel. And if you never knew what that word meant, it means God with us. God with us. And this phrase, Emmanuel, God with us, changed everything for these people. This was the answer they'd been waiting for and looking for hundreds and hundreds of years. Now, maybe you've kind of prayed one of those shotgun prayers, God be with me, once before in your life, right? Maybe it was as you were going on a blind date and you just thought, God, please be with me. Let this be the one. Maybe you shot up that. Or maybe it was when you've been shopping last week and you were like, God, please find me a closed parking spot right by the door. Maybe you said that kind of prayer. Maybe it was to protect you while you were traveling for holidays or something like that. Or maybe it was prayer, God, will you help me? Be with me as I take these finals I didn't study for. You know, I mean, it might be something like that. But this was a different kind of prayer that the Israelites were praying, because the world was captive and lonely. And this was the announcement that everyone was waiting to hear, that God would come and be with us. That God would come and be with us. Because up until this point, right, as you read the Old Testament, people couldn't personally know God. Only the priest could go into the temple. Only the priest could go into the Holy of Holies, into his presence. Even Moses, maybe you've heard of that guy, even Moses had to hide his face from God because of how great and powerful he was. But now, God would be with us. He would be one of us. And Jesus was born on that day, in that stable, placed in that manger, to be with us. And it's why the wise men came and bowed down, because it wasn't just a child. No, this was their God and their Savior in human flesh to be among us. Many people think that God is just some distant, faraway God, just like the song sings, right? God is watching us from a distance. Right? We just think he's this faraway entity that we could never reach, that certainly isn't interested in being involved in our lives. I mean, there's so many people. How could he care about every single one of us? But it's true that he's not impersonal. He chose to be Emmanuel. He chose to be a God who is with us, which means this, that God was with you, God is with you, and God will always be with you. That's an incredible thought. And it's incredible to think that even if you don't believe in God, that he believes in you. Always there, longing for relationship with us. I'm not talking about religion. I'm not talking about going to church and warming a chair and checking the box and jumping through the hoops. No, I'm talking about a real, living, personal relationship with Jesus, who lives in us and abides in us, makes us better at life, and makes life so much better. That's who Jesus is. I love what Luke 1:28 says, that the angel went to Mary and said, greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is, what's that word? The Lord is with you. I mean, that was mind-boggling to Mary. The Lord is with me. What a thought. And for every single one of us, that God always has been with you. God is with you. God will be with you. The chorus of this song continues. It says, O come, our day spring from on high, and cheer us by your drawing nigh. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night and death's dark shadows. Will you put them to flight? Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to you, O Israel. Interesting, this phrasing, gloomy clouds and death's dark shadows. And through it all, Jesus would be our day spring. He would be the sunrise that would pierce the darkness of our world. And maybe for you on a personal level, you would say that this year maybe you've experienced some gloomy clouds or death's dark shadow. Maybe this has been a really trying year or 2 years for you. And maybe you're wondering, God, where are you? God, are you even around? Are you even hearing what I'm saying? Maybe some of you that lost a loved one this year and there's an empty chair at the table. And the grieving that you're walking through seems insurmountable. And the loneliness and loss feels more real than ever. And you're wondering, God, are you there? Are you there to help me? Or maybe it's hard for you to darken the doors of a church, even if it isn't a school, because you think, well, God would never want me or accept me because of what I've done. Everything going on in my past, all the mistakes that I've made, there's no way that God would invite me in and want me to be a part of this thing. But the truth is that God has always been there. And God will always be with you. Never once taken his eye off of you. That is an amazing thought. If God was with you, he is with you, he will be with you. You say, Ryan, how do you know that's true? How do you know that his love can pierce through anything in my life, no matter where I've been, no matter how long I've been gone, no matter what I've done? How can you have such confidence in saying that? Because of a man named Paul, who used to be Saul. And he used to spend time persecuting and killing Christians until he had an encounter with Jesus on a road one day, and it absolutely changed his life. And he went from persecuting Christians to building the early church and being one of the men that wrote half of the New Testament. It's why you and I know what we know today. And he penned these words 2,000 years ago, Romans 8:35, he said, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? He's like, if you only knew what I've done, if you've only known where I've been, how long I've been on the outside of this thing, I can say with confidence, who shall be able to separate us from this love? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Go ahead and fill in the blank with your own deal. He says, no. In all of these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced, he says, that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in his son who was born on Christmas, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Nothing could separate us. Nothing in all the world. He's Emmanuel, God with us. The God that has been with us, the God that is with us, the God that will be with us for all who invite him in. He's there.